Hello, I'm Simon Whistler. You're watching Top 10s Net. In the video today, we're looking at the top 10 weapons and weapon systems that totally flopped. Just before we get started, I will say that this is a video that we've made in collaboration with historyandheadlines.com. It's written by Dr. Matthew Zarzechny. If you want to see more stuff by Matthew, please do head over to historyandheadlines.com. And in at number 10, it's the T-64, T-72, and T-80 tank from the USSR, and it debuted in the 1960s. Mobile, tough armor, and a huge 125mm gun, when US and Allied main tank guns were 105mm, with an automatic loader, allowing the crew to be reduced to one, no need for a loader, what is not to like? Well, the automatic loader requires the ready ammo to be stored around the inside perimeter of the turret, instead of in a secure, blast-proof compartment, as in the M60 and the M1 US tanks. In both Gulf Wars, when the T-72 was hit by an anti-tank weapon, the ammo inside the T-72 would often explode, causing a tremendous morale-busting explosion. Additionally, the automatic loader requires the gun returned to a certain angle for loading and reduces the range of elevation and depression in the gun. This was a fatal flaw in the mountainous terrain in Afghanistan. Number 9. Tail gun on the B-58 Hustler Mach 2 Bomber, 1960. This US bomber was built to outfly the interceptor and fighter jets of the 1950s when it was designed and developed, but by 1960, advances in ground-to-air missiles made the plane almost obsolete. Worse was including a 20mm Gatling gun-type rotary cannon in the tail for defensive purposes. When the B-58 was zipping along at Mach 2, which is 1,300 miles per hour, the 20mm rounds fired backwards would have so much forward momentum from the speed of the bomber that they would be totally ineffective as a weapon. All they would seem to do is float rearward in slow motion. All the gun did was add weight and hurt aerodynamics. Operational for only 10 years, the B-58 was retired in 1970. And here's an extra fact, if you are old enough to remember or have been told about them, in the 1960s when the B-58 would go on practice missions pretending to bomb US cities and fighters would try to intercept them, the sonic boom from the B-58s would wake up sleeping citizens, get dogs barking, and sometimes even break windows. Number 8. Gyrojet from the 1960s. An entire family of weapons were planned, firing little rockets from the barrel instead of bullets. The result was a very low recoil firearm that launched a gyroscopically controlled rocket projectile at low initial speed and accelerated it up to a more respectable 1,250 feet per second once it was on its way. Originally made in 51 caliber, the Gun Control Act of 1968 necessitated a change to 49 caliber. Rifles, pistols, and other weapons were planned with calibers up to 20mm. If you're sitting there and thinking, well, I bet that ammo's expensive, you would be absolutely correct. If you call $100 a shot expensive. Obviously, because it's included on this list, the Gyrojet was an inaccurate flop. Number 7. Krag Jorgensen Rifle, 1894-1904. The first smokeless powder main battle rifle for the US, this Norwegian rifle was well made and smooth to operate, but when it was used in combat during the Spanish-American War, it was found greatly inferior to the German Mausers used by the Spanish. The Mausers were loaded with stripper clips and could put out considerably more firepower in combat. The Krag was loaded by fumbling around with loose rounds through the side of the rifle, a much slower process in combat. Additionally, the round nose Krag bullet was less powerful and less aerodynamic than the competition, and having the short service life of only 10 years meant the Krag was replaced by the superb M1903 Springfield rifle, which was a Mauser copy. Number 8. Anti-tank dogs from the 1940s. Never passing up an opportunity to come up with some barbaric plan, the Soviets during World War II hit on the idea of placing an explosive on a dog that was trained to seek shelter under German tanks. The explosive would then be detonated by a wand that stuck up above the dog's back, which would hit the bottom of the target tank, blowing up the tank in the process. Unfortunately for the Reds, the dogs were trained to do their thing using Russian tanks as training aids. This meant that when the dogs were actually used in combat, they were more likely to run under Soviet tanks and blow them up, which was the end of this idea. Number 5. Individual Soldier Jetpack, 1940s to the 1960s. The impracticality of this idea never seems to discourage inventors from trying to perfect it. The problems of making a jet-powered rocket backpack to fly a soldier around without roosting the back of his legs is hard enough, but running out of the mere seconds of fuel is an unlucky thing if you are up in the air when that happens. Perhaps you've seen demonstrations at a football game where a soldier or airman wears such a device and he flies from one end of the field to the other. It's kind of nifty, but that's about as far as he can actually go. Number 4. The automatic revolver from 1900. This idea is a classic example of a solution to a problem that does not exist. Since a normal double-action revolver can be fired by just pulling the trigger repeatedly anyway, throwing in extra parts and complexity of making the pistol cycle automatically instead achieves no realistic advantage. The main advantage of a semi-auto pistol over a revolver rests in the ability to rapidly reload, as well as the ability to create a higher capacity firearm. If you increase the amount of ammo a revolver can carry, the cylinder becomes ridiculously big. This bad idea was first proposed in Norway in 1900 and followed by the Webley-Fosbury automatic revolver in 1901. French and Spanish manufacturers quickly followed, but the idea seemed to die out with the advent of decent semi-auto pistols. In 1997, the Mateba company of Italy felt compelled to try it again and built a modern version in 357 Magnum, 44 Magnum, and 454 Castle calibers. Manufacturing of this type of revolver ended in 2005, and you can expect to pay around $2,800 to $3,000 for one on the used market. Number 3. Dropping troops without a parachute from the 1930s. Those Soviets do just keep trying, and this time they outdid themselves. Due to a lack of expensive silk for parachutes, the workers' paradise dropped airborne soldiers from airplanes, sans parachutes, into deep snow. Now, right off, you can figure if the snow is deep enough to cushion their fall, how are they going to be able to climb back up to the top of the massive hole they've created when landing? And also, that's not to mention how much this would hurt in the summer. The plan would work only if the area had really deep snow, and one might be wondering at this point where on earth they got volunteers for this experiment. These humanitarians took things a step further and made Airbus and Hydrobus containers to drop troops in, the failure of which prompted Soviet officials to put the inventors in their creation and drop them, which seems to be finally a good idea from them. Number 2. Flying tanks, from the 1930s to the 1940s. Even today, this idea eludes a solution, but it had to be a lot harder back in the 30s and 40s when inventors kept trying to find ways to fly tanks into battle. Glider wings, strapping them to the bottom of bomber aircraft, and every other idea they tried did not work. In the 1960s, the US came up with a parachute-deployable tank, the M551 Sheridan. And the Soviets came up with light, tank-like, airdroppable vehicles of their own, but these were aluminium lighter vehicles and not really tanks. Number 1. The Maginot Line, 1940. After being invaded by Germany in World War I, France built the Maginot Line, a system of defensive forts along the French border with Germany. A massive undertaking of vast tunnels and bunkers with built-in railways to move troops and supplies, it also had ammo and provision to keep the French army fighting for as long as it took to repel the invaders. Of course, this was quite expensive and did not take into account the mobility of modern warfare – tanks, trucks, parachute troops, etc. Plus, the biggest blunder was not continuing the defensive line all the way to the coast, leaving the border with Belgium undefended. Even the Nazis could figure that one out and invaded France through Belgium by passing the expensive and wasted Maginot Line. So I really hope you found that video interesting. If you did, please do hit that thumbs up button below, and don't forget to subscribe for brand new videos just like this every day of the week. Also, over there on the right are a couple of other videos that you might enjoy if you enjoyed this one, and thank you for watching.